Welcome to this, the third in the series of Brexit lunchtime lectures arranged by the European Institute. We've already heard about the future of the EU after Brexit and the constitutional aftershock. Today we're going to hear about Brexit and the rise of Euroscepticism. My name's Tony Travers from the Department of Government and the IPA, and I'm here the minute to chair this afternoon. I've been told to say when we get to the Q&A, and there will be questions and answers at the end, stand up when you use the microphone so as to capture every word in clear glory. But I'll do little more by way of introduction than to say that our speaker today is Professor Sarah Hobolt, who is the Sutherland Chair in European Institutions and a leading light in these matters here at the LSE. Sarah.
Thank you, Tony. And thank you, everyone, for coming in your lunch break. So as Tony said, today I'll talk about the Brexit vote and look at it more generally in a sort of European comparative perspective. And I'll start with two quotes from the leading lights, so I don't know whether that's the word, but certainly the man and the woman of the moment. We'll start with our very own Theresa May. In this recent quote in her big speech on what Brexit means, she said, "The message from the public before and during the referendum campaign was clear. Brexit must mean control of the number of people who come to Britain from Europe, and that is what we will deliver." And this is very significant because we know that on the ballot, of course, it only said whether or not you want Britain to leave the European Union, not do you want to end Europeans coming to Britain or so on, do you want to end membership of the single market, and all these other policy questions that we're now facing. But what happens when you have this binary choice in a referendum is that then, of course, it becomes a question of what did people think when they voted, and how can we interpret that, and how can we deliver that in a way that's responsive. So that's why that research on trying to understand and disentangle the vote becomes important politically and normatively. So that's the first question that we can look at today. The second question relates to this quote of the man of the moment, Donald Trump, who keeps me up at night in anxiety and sort of hot sweats at night thinking, oh, is it all going to be nuclear war? But let's leave that aside. He has another prediction here. You look at the European Union and it's Germany, basically a vehicle for Germany. That's why I thought the UK was so smart in getting out. I believe others will leave. I do think keeping it together is not going to be as easy as a lot of people think. So that's the second inspiration for today's talk, which is this idea, well, is this just the beginning? Is there going to be a domino or a contagion effect? So these are the two questions I will try to address and that we can talk about. So why did British voters choose to Brexit? And is this an outlier or is it just a sign of a rising tide of Euroscepticism across Europe? So let's start with Brexit. And let's not forget that while it's in many ways is unique and to many came as a surprise, it was not the first referendum on European integration, and perhaps it shouldn't have come as much as a surprise as it did if we had taken seriously the lessons from those referendums. So since 2000 alone, we've had about 25 referendums related to the EU, not membership, but related to questions to do with treaty ratification and ratification of specific policies. And in all of these cases, we've had a political establishment and a pro-business or a sort of business and political elite that were very consensually in favor of these proposals. But nonetheless, we've seen that in 10 out of these 25, the public, the voters rejected them. So in other words, it's not unusual that you go into referendums on questions on Europe and the public goes against what we would think of as the political and the economic mainstream. And the same, of course, happened in the Brexit referendum, although here, in fact, we had a more divided political elite than we've often seen in other EU referendums. And what are then the lessons, if we look at these EU referendums, that can also shed some light on what happened in Brexit? Well, first of all, is that the campaign matters. So attitudes on Europe are very malleable. They change a lot. So it's not that people generally have very fully formed certain views that this is what they want Europe to look like, this is where they want their country to be in Europe. Of course, there's certain people who are just hardcore Euroskeptics. They want to be out no matter what. And there are people who just love Europe. They're Eurofederalists. So you get these camps. But generally, attitudes on Europe are far more malleable than attitudes, for example, in a general election, where people often have strong partisanship and they'll vote for the same party over and over again. So you see much bigger changes in individual attitudes in a referendum campaign compared with a general election campaign. And since attitudes are malleable, it also matters a lot what parties say. So many voters will take cues from their political parties, although, of course, not everyone, because if they did, you would have outcomes in line with the recommendations of parties. One reason you don't get that is that parties are often divided, and we saw that, of course, very clearly in the Brexit vote. Third point is this point that the reversion point is crucial. And what do I mean by that? I mean that people are not only voting for what they're for and against, in terms of a status quo, but also what they think will happen if they reject the status quo. What do they think, what did British people think would happen if they voted to leave? And this is quite crucial here, because I think the reason that many on the Remain side felt quite confident, and the reason that the markets and so on, for example, underestimated the chance of a Brexit, despite polls that weren't actually that far off, but they really underestimated it if you looked at the markets, is because they thought there is this inherent risk aversion and status quo bias. I'll come back to that. And then finally, the EU referendums are not just about the EU. We're not just voting about what do we want the European Union to look like, do we want to be a part of that, but a lot of other issues play a role in EU referendums, including that people want to send a message to the political establishment, might be dissatisfied with the government, and so on. Now, going back to the Remain side being confident, I remember having a discussion with a senior civil servant in the cabinet office before the vote, and I was saying, ooh, this is looking a little too exciting for my taste, or something like that. I said, what is the feeling within the government? And he said, we're feeling very good and very calm about this because we have won the argument. And I thought, what argument is that? It was clearly not an argument about the European Union being this amazing thing we had to be a member of, because that could not possibly be the argument, because it's not the argument that was put forward for the government. The argument that they thought they had won was this argument. Namely, would Britain be better or worse off economically if they left the European Union? That was the government's argument, that Britain would be worse off economically leaving the EU. And they thought, we have won that argument. The poll shows us we've won that argument. And that's why ultimately, in the ballot box, people will go in and they will think about their own pockets, they will think about job security, they will think about prices, and they will vote the way that is the sensible, rational way to do in that situation. But these numbers are quite interesting. You can see why they thought they won the argument. This was from June 2016, 37% says Britain will be worse off, and only 22% thinks Britain will be better off. But now, look at that other column here. So 26% thought there would be no difference, and 15% didn't know. So if you add up the people who thought Britain would be better off, or the people who thought it would make no difference, you of course have a majority in favor of, you know, fair enough. Might be better, or it might not, but so, you know, but that, I think that was, I mean, Tony will have, probably have more of these conversations than I, but I think there was a certain complacency related to this thing, that the economic argument would ultimately win the day. So what actually happened in the campaign? I mean, it's very recent, so you will all be aware of this. We know that it was a very close race from the get-go. Here are the polls showing. There was the Remain side almost throughout the campaign, although not the entire time, had a lead. There were some differences between online polls and telephone polls and so on, but they looked like they had a narrow lead. This poll might suggest that really there were no changes at all. People had sort of made up their mind on day one. But that's not the case. I mean, these sort of very stable lines, they are sort of concealing the fact that many people did change their mind throughout the campaign. Another interesting aspect of this campaign was it was really led by the Conservative Party when you saw the coverage in the media, and it was really led by a split within the Conservative Party. So the most prominent campaigners was, on the one hand, you know, the Prime Minister and Chancellor on the Remain side, and on the Leave side, Boris Johnson and Michael Gove, and to an extent Nigel Farage. So the opposition played a more subdued role, you could say. There was polling showing that sort of 30% of Labour supporters in the period leading up to the referendum didn't even know which side the Labour Party was on. For me, really, the most striking of this was, I don't know if any of you saw this interview with Jeremy Corbyn, where he was asked, you know, how strongly do you feel about Britain's membership of the European Union? And he was sort of on a scale from 0 to 10. I think he even introduced this scale concept. I'm not sure it was the interview. Maybe 6 or 7. I mean, this was in the midst of the campaign, a 6 or 7. I mean, seriously, you know, you can see if you're a supporter and you say, yeah, you know, it doesn't exactly make this a strong cue or recommendation to your supporters. So I think that was an important issue, that the party queuing from the Conservative Party was obviously right down the middle, and from the Labour Party was very ambivalent. Okay, so what were the main issues again? It was interesting that you had quite clear messaging in this campaign compared to a lot of referendum campaigns that I've studied. The Remain camp was very united in terms of that this was about the economic dangers of Brexit. There wasn't much of a positive argument put out. This was this phrase that this is a leap in the dark. This was also dubbed by the Leave side as Project Fear. On the Leave side, there was more mixed arguments, but they centered around issues of immigration and sovereignty and this slogan of taking back control, not least of borders and immigration. There was relatively limited discussion of issues to do with Europe, European institutions, a democratic deficit. I mean, even from the Leave side, that wasn't so much of a focus. It was more, what are the consequences of membership on Britain as opposed to what does the European Union look like? You will be aware of some of these campaigns. Of course, the Breaking Point poster there on the Farage end of the Leave side was very much criticized. But you can see that's clearly a sort of a negative image. You have a sort of standard Remain side poster here that 3 million UK jobs are linked to our trade with the EU, with the implication implying that these jobs would be lost. So what a colleague and a former PhD student here at the LSE and I did was we ran this survey of 5,000 respondents trying to see, well, what of these messages, campaign messages, are really filtering down? I'll show you this first. So what are the sort of filtering down into the to citizens? And we asked these 5,000 people to describe in their own words, sort of open-ended, what are the sort of issues that you think about? What are the arguments you've heard in the campaign? And here, these are just some word clouds that are divided by whether or not you are mainly a Remainer or a Leaver. You can probably guess, not sure I have to label them, so you can probably guess which cloud is what. But here, I'll show you, sort of, we ran this sort of structural topic model where we took all these text information and looked at what topics do they cluster into. And then along this horizontal axis, we look at how does that load on whether or not you were likely to vote Leave or Remain. And there we see on the Remain side, it's very much about economic benefits of the EU, economic stability in the EU, economic risk of Brexit. And on the other side, we find immigration control, no trust in the Prime Minister, the government, and the cost of EU as the main arguments. So that, in a sense, is very much in line with what we saw from the campaigns. Clearly, they were effective in cueing people, priming people to what to think about. And clearly there was very big divisions in terms of, on the one hand, Remainers who bought this economic argument of the risk, and on the other hand, on the Leave side, where the argument was much more about the risk and the threat of immigration and loss of sovereignty. Although, as you can see, sovereignty is not really a big issue. So we also ran an experiment, and I should say that given this didn't work out, so I'll show it to you because I'm sure no one will ever publish it, but so tend to, as a researcher, you set up an experiment too because you want it to work. And in this experiment, we were priming people to think about the uncertainty. And my expectation would be if you prime people about the uncertainty of leaving the EU, given everything we think we know about status quo bias and risk aversion, people would then be more likely to want to vote to leave. Yeah, that's the idea. So we prime people by saying experts point out that the consequences of leaving in the European Union is very uncertain and difficult to predict. Now, what's interesting here is we didn't get any effects. And that's not to say you can't get effect in these kind of survey experiments. I could have gotten lots of effects in survey experiments that I ran during Brexit. Like you can tell Cameron says this and people who like Cameron will be more like this and so on. So you can move people. But this did not get any effect, and that came as a bit of a surprise, but clearly telling in terms of the outcome. If you told people that there's an uncertainty about what the European Union will look like if we remain, there wasn't an effect on being less likely to be remain, but the depressed turnout instead. So people were saying less likely to say they would turn out. So this does raise this question about that clearly the government and others, including experts, thought that this fear-mongering, this idea of making people, priming people's uncertainty, and especially economic uncertainty and risk aversion would work. There was this wisdom, you know, sort of shared wisdom that this is what worked in Scotland. You know, people were afraid in the Scottish independence referendum about what would happen to their economy and so on if Scotland were to become independent. And there was also, I think, prevailing wisdom that this is what happened in the 2015 general election, that this kind of idea of economic certainty played a role in the Conservatives doing well. So that was the sort of idea, and clearly, not to say the economy and the economic uncertainty of Brexit didn't work, but it didn't work on a majority of voters. So then the question is, it's always nicer to for political scientists to explain things when they've happened than to try and predict them. So now there's these different wisdoms. What then happened? What was it that then swung voters to vote to leave? And one argument that came out a lot, especially just in the aftermath, is this was really about the economy, but not in the economy in terms of uncertainty of Brexit, but this was the losers of globalization, the left behind voters and left behind regions who were aggrieved and thought this is our chance to protest and to say how unhappy we are, and the sort of establishment, political establishment in London, the establishment in Brussels, we're going to tell them all where to go, and we now feel empowered through this vote. Another argument was more to do with identity, which was that, well, this is really a sort of nostalgia for bygone times. That's why you find older voters being much more likely to vote for Brexit. Also, it was driven by concerns of immigration and multiculturalism. And so it's about to identity, and a particular people with strong English identity would be much more likely to vote to leave. And then there's a sort of an argument saying, well, this is really just a populist protest about anti-establishment. It's not to do, you know, specifically with the EU, but just a revolt against the establishment and a protest against the government and the elite. You'll find interesting that none of these explanations focuses particularly on the EU as such, but much more generally about aspects to do with the political system as such, that's not just specifically to the European Union. Let's look at some of the evidence for these different theses and see where it takes us. So one is aggregate level evidence, and I'll come to some individual level evidence. So let's look at the regional differences first. So here's a pretty map. Blue is blue color for staying in the European Union. Yellow is the yellow color for leaving. You can see, of course, England was overwhelmingly in favor of leaving, and Scotland, of course, for remaining. You can see that some of the bigger cities, London, so on, were where there was also a majority for remaining, and of course in Northern Ireland. And first, let's say, what about this economic thesis, this sort of losers of globalization left behind thesis? How well does it do if we look at the aggregate level? Well, first of all, Brexit was strongest in the area where a large percentage of the population didn't have any qualifications. So that suggests, well, maybe these are people who feel they're left behind by globalization, and where there are a lot of older people. But it wasn't a simple story about deprivation. So we don't really see any relationship between deprived areas and voting for leave. There were a lot of much richer areas that voted for leave. There were a lot of very poor areas, especially in the big metropolitan cities like London, that voted to remain. Scotland and Northern Ireland, of course, also shows these are not particularly rich areas generally, but they show that there's a definitely a political queuing story that the Scottish elite mobilized much more clearly behind Remain and so on. So just to show you some graphs here, this is the aggregate level graph between local authority areas that voted to leave and percentage with no qualifications, and there we see a quite nice correlation. I could show you the same for sort of university level graduates, and you would see the reverse graph. Yeah. So on that prediction, I would say, you know, everyone in here, this room should have voted to remain, because that's the sort of, you fit that demographic. You're in London and you are university educated, so clearly you would vote to remain. If anyone wants to put up their hand and say they voted to leave, you could, that way you would be one of these outliers. But that's my general prediction. Yeah. But what about if we look at deprivation? You know, there we really don't see that nice correlation. And especially because down there you will see, you know, big city areas like Lambeth, Hackney, and so on, Oxford, a university town, where really you have sort of deprivation, Tower Hamlets, Manchester, Liverpool. You have high levels of deprivation, but you don't have a high leave score. So clearly there was more to the story than it was just. And we'll see the same if we go to the individual level. So now I analyzed the British election study to try and look at some of the individual level predictors. And firstly, the top two is really looking at parties. So we see the Labour supporters were much more likely to vote to remain. And you can say that is because of or despite of Jeremy Corbyn, depending on which view you take. Conservative supporters were more likely to vote to leave. Again, we can't necessarily say, you know, there's a sort of clear causal effect. It might also be people who were, anyway, you're a skeptic, were more likely to be Conservative supporters. But clearly there was that effect. So David Cameron and Osborne did not manage to persuade most of their supporters. There's also a relationship with populist attitudes. So if you generally were anti-elite, anti-establishment, you were more likely to vote to leave. If you lack trust in politicians, you were more likely to leave. There's also some support for the identity story. So people with a British or particularly an English identity were more likely to vote to leave. If you had a European identity, well, you were more likely to vote to remain, not surprisingly, but there aren't a lot of people in this country who say they have a European identity. Indeed, not a lot of people in Europe who say they have a European identity. So, income, it's quite interesting. Again, it goes against this simple deprivation story. There's no relationship between income and how you voted, at the aggregate level or the individual level. It's not a simple income story. That doesn't mean that I'm sort of the belief that that means that it has nothing to do with your position in the labor market. I mean, clearly education also tells you something about your prospects, your opportunities, and so on. But it's not clearly, it's not a simple income story. In terms of demographics, the two key predictors are education and age. Again, you're young, you're graduates, you would have voted to remain. If you're old and with fewer qualifications, you would have voted to leave. And so one debate to have is, what is it education does that matters so much here? It's a much bigger gap, this education gap, by the way, than what we saw in the presidential election for Trump. There are parallels, but nowhere near. And if we look at political attitudes generally, you don't get anything that looks that stark when it comes to education. So I think it is an interesting but also open question. What is it about education? Is it a sort of cognitive mobilization? You think differently about Europe, or you think differently about immigrants, or is it more like you think you see your prospects in terms of your opportunities in Europe, more sort of political economy story? I think that's something still for us as scholars of these things that we should try and examine. But clearly, the evidence is clear that education matters. Of course, attitude also matters. You know, attitudes always matter in these things. You know, you ask people whether or not you think the EU has made it more prosperous. If you think that's rubbish, the EU clearly hasn't made the UK more prosperous, then you're more likely to vote to leave. if you don't believe the Project Fear story that Brexit will reduce trade, basically the Leavers tended to not believe it. They didn't necessarily think Britain would be more prosperous, but they certainly didn't think it would make it less prosperous. Arguments about UK Parliament overriding EU law also mattered, and that the EU basically, if people believed that the EU had prevented war, that had some positive effect. And then identity factors were very important if you look at attitudinal factors. The EU has undermined British identity. If you said affirmative to that, then you had a 25 percentage point more likely to vote to leave. And immigration also mattered, but not as strongly. Brexit will lower immigration. If you thought that to be the case, you're more likely. And if you were generally anti-EU migrants, there was also a significant effect. So yeah, that maybe not tell us such a clear story, but I guess the Leave vote was a mix of identity argument, but also not buying the economic story from the government that the effects would be as bad as people, as they were told. And of course that is again linked to the fact that if you don't believe what experts or politicians tell you, if you have this anti-political elite feeling, then why would you believe their arguments about the economy? Okay, so that gets us to Trump. So we know he's been right about a lot of things, yes? He said Britain would leave the European Union, vote Brexit, and they did. He said he would win the presidential election, and he did. So clearly, he does better than a lot of professors at these institutions in terms of predicting political events. So let's see. So this was his latest prediction here, that others will leave the European Union too. It's not going to stay together. Is he right? Well, we don't know yet, but what does the evidence tell us? I think he's more sort of intuition kind of guy myself. I'm not sure he's big on evidence, but what does the evidence tell us? Well, first of all, there's a lot of this sort of, Euroscepticism is on the right, so it's off the charts. Everyone hates the EU. But it's not so clear from the survey evidence that's what we're seeing, although the behavioral evidence might tell us a different things. By that, I mean voting behavior. So here's a graph of support for EU membership. And I've divided this into four groups. So North Eurozone countries, like Germany, Finland, and North non-Eurozone countries, Sweden, Denmark, Britain, South, Southern Europe, and Eastern Europe. And what we see is that there was a bit of a dip around the finance sovereign debt crisis. By the way, I don't have the latest figures, but that's sort of picked up again. That support for membership is actually fairly high in the Northern Eurozone. It's a bit lower, obviously, in the Northern non-Eurozone, so Britain, Sweden, and Denmark. In the South, it's sort of changed a lot more, and in Eastern Europe, it's about 50%. If you ask about more or less integration, so do you want to speed up integration or do you want to slow it down, you see a slightly different picture. So here we see that in Southern Europe, people are much more keen to speed up European integration than in Northern Europe. Partly, of course, because they might believe that it's related to more redistribution of resources to Southern Europe. So the same in Eastern Europe. I'll get to questions that look specifically at support for membership in a referendum situation. But one thing we should keep in mind that behind all these surveys, a reason why a lot of people say Euroscepticism is on the rise, is off the charts, is because of this, that it's become much more vocal. It's become much more vocal in two ways, that people are specifically blaming the EU for things that are happening to their economy, to immigration and so on. And people are voting for parties that have a Eurosceptic view. But does that mean that we're going to see more exits? Well, there's sort of two key procedural sort of requirements before we're going to see other countries leaving the European Union. One is that there's going to have to be some kind of referendum, and it's unlikely this will be done purely in a parliament. And secondly, that referendum has to result in an exit. Now, that might seem obvious, but I mention these two things because, first of all, Britain was a bit, was unusual in that it had a major mainstream governing party that had been split on the issue of the EU for decades. So in other words, a lot of this was not a bottom-up kind of Euroscepticism, we have to have a vote on this, but was really top-down, the fact that you had a referendum ultimately because of an internal debate in the British Conservative Party. And in that sense, Britain is unusual. It doesn't mean it's impossible. You can imagine a situation where Marine Le Pen wins the French presidential election. In that case, he might well call a referendum. In that case, we get to point two, which is an electorate likely to vote in favor of an exit? And here we'll look at some of the issues, but one is to do with how appealing is the exit option. And Britain was in a quite unique situation that politically and economically citizens thought that British political institutions were much superior to the EU, and the British economy and economic conditions were also superior. So it seemed quite appealing being outside. It wasn't very convincing that Brexit would really be that disastrous when you looked across the channel and you saw what was going on in the EU. That said, of course, across the EU, anti-EU Eurosceptic feeling are being mobilized, and in the wake of Brexit, you saw the French Front National calling for now France. We have Brexit, now France is going to free itself from the shackles of Europe. We have Wilders, so these are two countries, of course, that are having elections this year, that's saying, also using the sort of anti-immigration, putting down the barrier to immigrants coming into the Netherlands. And the final one is a Danish poster saying, now we have to ask the people before, you know, this EU hand crushing the Danish flag. But is Britain an outlier when it comes to attitudes towards staying? If we asked people specifically, if there were a referendum tomorrow on EU membership, what would you vote? And YouGov have done that, going back to 2012, and the dark blue line in the bottom there is Britain. So again, these anti-EU feeling were not mobilized just in the referendum, yeah? I mean, clearly, anyone calling a referendum, deciding to call a referendum, looking at these graphs should have thought, well, you know, has a great belief in his own powers of persuading people. Because there clearly was an underlying feeling. And I always thought, if there's one country that's going to leave the European Union if a referendum was called, it would be Britain. Because these figures, this sort of exit, hardcore exit Euroscepticism, in other words, we want to leave, is not a new phenomenon in Britain. Although, of course, there's been lots of changes over the years. And we see that that other countries are generally less likely. This is sort of net remain support. Although there you can see Sweden is also quite Eurosceptic, France also. There was a tick up, by the way, after the Brexit referendum in support for membership. People like, ooh, that doesn't look like something we want to get into. Which again relates then to the negotiations. There's another data here I want to show you. Again, keep in mind when you look at these data what I said about EU attitudes being highly malleable. Any point estimate at this point in time when a referendum is not a real possibility in any of these countries could look very vastly different when a campaign is starting to play out. So I'm not trying to say that, oh, we know this is going to happen or not, just to say what's the underlying feeling that we're picking up now. And this is also a question of referendum. Imagine there's a referendum and you can decide whether your country stays as a member of the European Union. How would you vote? Now look at this. August 2016. France and Italy has a lower support for membership in a hypothetical referendum than the UK. Again, that doesn't mean a referendum would be lost, but certainly it's within the territory that any president or prime minister deciding this would be a great thing to do, while still wanting their country to remain in, should feel a bit concerned. So what explains the sort of underlying Euroscepticism? I'm just going to quickly talk you through some of the main factors. So for a long time, we thought this is all about economic cost-benefit analysis. We know at the individual level that it's highly correlated with education, just like we saw in the Brexit referendum. Also, then, I've been an argument, it's about lack of benefits from membership, but there's less evidence for this. Then, a sort of alternative or competing theory has been about, it's all about identity, especially people with an exclusive national identity didn't want to vote, are sort of against the EU, or people who hold anti-immigration, anti-globalization attitudes. And then again, this mobilization by the elite. So these attitudes are often not formed in a vacuum. Most people don't have a very direct experience with the EU. What they do have is what they hear from their politicians. And what we've seen is a rise of challenger parties, particularly on the populist right, but also on the populist left. And the EU, for them, have become one of their key issues. And often they've linked it quite successfully, especially on the right, with issues to do with migration. and with issues to do with anti-establishment attitudes. And of course, the EU is, you know, kind of the remote bureaucracy and establishment. And then Euroscepticism is also what I and Catherine de Vries have called reference point dependent, which means that it's not just about what you think about the EU, it's how when you think, it's what you think about the EU relative to what the alternative is, which is the national. So if you look like your country is doing better in terms of political institutions, governance, quality of governance, if your economy looks like it's actually doing better than the rest of the EU or being in the EU, then you have a viable exit option. Britain had a viable exit option. The economy was doing relatively better than the Eurozone. People have relative higher levels of trust in national institutions in Britain than they do in institutions. So, and that's not the case for all countries in the EU. Some countries in the EU, they might look at the EU and think, ooh, it's not great. But they will look at their national politician and say, well, they're disastrous. Or they will look at their national economy and say, so in other words, it's a relative assessment. Now, Catherine de Vries have looked at that in terms of exit, the exit appeal and the viability. And the quadrant that you should be interested in is are those called exit skeptics. Over here. So the exit skeptics are interesting because those are the ones that both in terms of support for the regime, the political institutions and the policy in the EU think that the EU is inferior to the national alternative. And there we see in 2008, we have Finland in that quadrant and we have Sweden, sort of just on the edge. But if we fast forward to 2015, not surprisingly, we've had the sovereign debt crisis and so on. She switched the colors around, sorry. But now the red ones are the ones with a viable exit option. Then we have Sweden, Great Britain, Austria, the Netherlands. In other words, if we look at public opinion, there are a lot of electorates there that actually feel that the national their national political institutions and policies are potentially better, and that also have viable exit options in terms of if we look at the quality of governance and the economic conditions in those countries. Of course, that might shift again as the EU takes off, but that's the situation. It was the situation in 2015. Okay, in conclusion then. So what the referendum provided clearly was a mandate for Brexit. There was a very long campaign. It was made very clear by the Remain side that this was a vote to leave the European Union. It wasn't a sort of, oh, you get to have your say, but maybe we'll stay in and we'll have a second choice. This was made very clear. It was, compared to most other EU referendum, a very intense, high saliency affair. So you couldn't argue that people were not made aware of the consequences of leaving, and they voted, a majority voted to leave. Yet, of course, a lot of the debate now over these next 2 years is going to be about that didn't necessarily tell us what kind of Brexit. So as we saw from the first quote from Theresa May, she's clearly decided that the main priority was immigration. And you can see why. You know, immigration clearly mattered to leavers. But that doesn't mean that it was because they were like, we're going to be willing to bear a huge economic cost. It was more that most leavers thought there wouldn't be a huge economic cost. It is also the case that, of course, for a large proportion of people who voted to remain, and also others, they thought the economic arguments mattered a great deal. So again, it's not that clear cut, but it is obviously hard because what referendums produce is just this binary result. You know, do you want to leave, do you want to stay, and not answers to sort of complicated policy trade-offs. But as we said, that this hard Brexit strategy that the government has adopted, which wasn't obvious from the campaign going in, can be seen as a response to an interpretation of this vote that was about immigration. What about the Trump prediction that this is going to trigger other referendums? That's not clear that that will be the case, although it's not impossible. I know it seems like I'm sort of hedging my bets, but it's not obvious to see, you know, the path to other exit is not as obvious as it was in this country where there was a party willing to put it on the agenda and there was a population that was clearly predisposed against the European Union membership to a different degree than in most other member states. One thing, though, to be clear about is that the kind of forces and the kind of socio-economic divides that we saw played out in the Brexit campaign are very much alive and doing well, or whatever you want to say, in the rest of Europe, with the rise of populist parties, especially on the rise, where anti-immigration attitudes and Eurosceptic attitudes are a key part of the political platforms. So I shall leave you with this last poster, which I think they are feeling, particularly in the US, certain parts of the US population at the moment. Let's just never ask the public for their views ever again. Thank you.
Okay, beautiful exposition there of a subject which clearly has affected the UK profoundly, but which may yet affect other countries as well. And looking at those charts towards the very end there, with the quadrants with Finland and Sweden, and then more countries moving that way, it's hard not to see that the countries that were moving that way, or that were in this quadrant, or were moving in that way, tended to be higher GDP and more central countries in Europe. Not all of them, but certainly higher GDP. And those that were in the far quadrant away from them, most in favour, tended to be lower GDP per head, and in some cases more peripheral. And again, the peripherality is less strong than the GDP per head, I guess. Is that an element in it, that the Finns and the Swedes look at EU institutions, given that the Finns and the Swedes and the Danes always come top of the, you know, indices of good, transparent government? Is it that they look at the EU and think, compared with our systems, these look less transparent, more ineffective, to put it delicately? Is that what's underpinning that, do you think?
No, I think that's exactly right. That this is this sort of what I inelegantly termed this reference point dependent idea of Euroscepticism, that it's not just about you look at the EU and you think, how well has the EU, you know, what has it done for the economy, what has it done for immigration? If you're really thinking about, do I want to leave the European Union as a citizen, you're also thinking, well, what is then the alternative to that? And it used to be the case with Italy, was a good point in case, that they were very keen to transfer sovereignty and very keen to have the euro instead of the lira, exactly because it seemed like their own politicians did such a disastrous job in managing the economy that sort of transferring power to German bankers seemed rather attractive. Whereas if you're in Sweden and you think, oh, we have the best institutions in the world, look, everything is going so well, why would you want to? So that's clear. And the euro crisis was another good example of that, that you could ask, why did support for the euro remain so high in countries like Greece, where it actually remained quite high and stable? That seems ludicrous after everything being a member of the euro has done to Greece. And part of it was, well, what is the alternative? Yeah. The alternative of being outside the euro, being governed by your own politicians and government, seemed potentially even more disastrous. So I think that point is this reference point that we're comparing. How do we perceive? Some of it is objective, some of it is subjective. And interesting with the Brits, even though they are critical of their own institutions, they have quite high levels of trust in the quality of governance in compared to Southern Europe, for example.
Okay, now are there any questions or comments that anybody would like to come forward feel free to ask a question. Yeah. And now you've got to, can you stand up and use the microphone? Sorry about that.
Sorry. Hello. Thank you for your presentation. I was just wondering about, you didn't mention turnout and possibly the effect it could have had on the Brexit, because all the surveys, I guess, were basically you ask anybody in the street, or I guess there are some criteria in choosing who you ask those questions, but I guess, don't you think turnouts had a very big impact on the vote for Brexit?
That's a very, very good question. It was interesting in the run-up to the referendum, of course, there was a lot of speculation about turnout. And the theory was always, well, people on the Leave side are more committed than Remainers, so they're more likely to turn out. So high turnout would be good for the Remain side, because that means that also the less committed have turned out. And of course, what we saw was that there was high turnout for a referendum, yet the Leave side still won. So in that sense, it's not clear case that, okay, we had 50% turnout, but it was only those who hated the European Union or vice versa. So in that sense, there was high turnout. Now, could there still be some turnout differential? I mean, of course, we saw this big generational divide that I mentioned, and younger people are generally less likely to turn out, and they were less likely to turn out here. So if young people had turned out in the same proportion that older people had turned out, then it would have been a Remain vote. So it's clear that turnout mattered in that sense, but you can't sort of just say, oh, it was a low turnout referendum. It was a high turnout referendum. There's some evidence that perhaps some of the Remain regions had relatively, especially in Scotland and so on, had sort of turnout was a bit on the lower side. So it might still have mattered, but not to the extent that I think some people in the Remain side feared that they couldn't mobilize. But I think, again, going back to this issue of like the Labour Party being a bit maybe not the mobilizing force they could have been. Again, for me, that was an issue of did they not necessarily persuade their own voters, but did they mobilize enough their own voters?
I mean, I think I'm right in saying you've mentioned that in Scotland, which voted to remain, turnout was actually curiously lower. Mm-hmm. One of the points that some political scientists have made is that in this election, i.e. the referendum, unlike most UK, or certainly all UK parliamentary elections, votes counted in this election, the referendum, one for one. That is, a vote in a rock-solid Labour or Conservative constituency, non-marginal constituency, was exactly the same as any other. And for many left-behind Labour and Conservative voters in safe seats who get no attention in a British general election, for once, their vote counted one for one with everybody else's. Do you think that's an element in this too?
I mean, you did see mobilisation for voters who didn't vote before. I mean, that's not something you necessarily only see you also see that sort of for the far right in Europe, where you have PR systems. So yeah. I don't think it can be attributed only to the safe seat. I haven't done the analysis. It'd be interesting to do an analysis of where they're very safe seat. Did you see more mobilization of sort of voters? But certainly there was a sense that there was a more passion on the Leave side, and therefore also greater mobilization than on the Remain side. Interestingly, there seems to be a bit more after the vote and the outcome, a bit more passion around the idea of staying in the European Union, and perhaps there was before the vote.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. Another question, yeah, back there. I'm sorry, can you, again, sorry to make you stand up and all of that, but.
Thank you very much. So there was this interesting YouGov study on authoritarian populism quite recently, which binds into the, let's say, the values argument rather than the economy one. So they identify that authoritarian populism as they say that AFD, Brexit, Trump, like branches of the same tree, and identifying this tendency among voters who increasingly maybe embrace positions which are anti-immigration, which are closed rather than open. And so they identify this as usually with anti-EU positions as well. Now, interestingly enough, the country within Europe that they identify as being the highest in this authoritarian populism is Romania, with 82%. And in Romania, actually, all the parties are pro-EU rather than anti-EU. So this ties very well with your reference point dependent theory, which I think is really useful. So I was reflecting that, so there were no data for, let's say, other Eastern European countries that are accessing the EU. But I was reflecting that my hunch is that actually this authoritarian populism tendency is quite high, probably among the population, even though in terms of political outcomes, it's not represented precisely because of the reason that all the parties are pro-EU, because they see some economic benefit out of it. And as you said, also the population sees the EU probably as the better alternative between the two. So I was just wondering, with this, with the pull factor of the EU and also the West in general getting weaker and weaker in Eastern European countries, can this, and it's actually already happening, that the EU is becoming less and less popular in these countries as well? And I mean, is this maybe not in the EU's interest that it's losing other enthusiasts on its borders? And maybe can this be a reason to, let's say, well, still pay attention to EU accession countries and so on, and pay attention to these developments on its borders. I don't know if it made sense what I said.
I mean, I think those are, you know, there are many points there and excellent points. I mean, you do, of course, see Euroscepticism amongst some of these governments, but it doesn't translate into the kind of Euroscepticism that we want to lead. You know, we see that even in Hungary. I mean, it's not that it's exactly pro-European language you hear, but it's not, we don't want to leave the European Union. And some of that, I think, exactly has to do with that there are some very tangible benefits. You know, countries that are clearly net beneficiaries, and then there's also, of course, political and historical reasons for wanting to be in the EU. But also, you know, when you're clearly an economic net beneficiary, if you're in Finland or in Sweden, it's a lot less unclear those very tangible benefits. So I think that's not to say, exactly as you say, not to say we find less populist, less authoritarian tendencies amongst the populists, but that, not just at the party level, but also at the individual level, that people see that there are clear tangible benefits. And again, going back to this reference point, do they rather want to be, you know, is it that much more attractive to reject the EU in favor of giving more powers to their own national politicians? Not necessarily. So I think your analysis is right there. In terms of the decline in support in Central and Eastern Europe, I mean, that's something we always see, that there's generally at the height of, you know, you join, and then there tends to be always, especially, you know, from the Central and Eastern European countries that joined in 2004 and 2007, there's been a decline. You know, it goes, there's a decline. That's not surprising as such, but it's still relatively high levels in Central and Eastern Europe with some exceptions. But yes, I mean, the more general point about what should the EU do, should they not ignore their periphery? Yes, of course. I mean, I generally think that the EU needs to focus a bit more on what can they do in terms of, you know, tangible benefits for people, so that it makes sense, as opposed to sort of maybe grand institutional projects.
Another point. Yep. Here. Good. Stand up. Sorry to make you stand up.
I'd like to come back to your point about the alternatives that were on voters' minds, and there are countries who are in Europe but not in the EU, and two obvious ones are Norway and Switzerland. To what extent was this on voters' minds, do you think?
And it's a good question, and of course it's a very topical and relevant one right now, where of course politicians are saying, oh no, you know, people voted to leave the European Union, not halfway. You know, people will say, who are, you know, in favor of the hard Brexit, you know, to come all the way out, and they voted for the end to freedom of movement, so therefore we clearly have to leave the single market. They voted to create their own trade deal, so we clearly have to leave the customs unions and so on. And then you get on the other side, no, people did not vote to. And of course, I mean, this is a question where you can never get the right answer, because ultimately that was not the question on the ballot. There was not a unified, this is the unified leave model, as you well know. It was not like the leave side said, this is the model you will be voting for. It was all over the place. So it's going to be absolutely impossible at this point in time to say, no, voters had exactly this in mind. First of all, a lot of voters are not going to be thinking about and having any knowledge or particular understanding of any models. Second of all, you know, to the extent they did, there might have been a whole range of them. You know, there was a whole range. We try and create these averages and mean effects and so on, because there are, of course, a lot of reasons why you might be a leaver or remainer. So I think that's not to say we shouldn't study this, but given that that question was not put in terms of those trade-offs, you can't then subsequently go and say, no, it's precisely that model. What we do know, of course, is when we do ask about these trade-offs, is that ultimately, I guess, it has to do with not that people want Switzerland or Norway, but what level of economic pain are people willing to accept? And that was not necessarily an argument that was presented, to be fair, by the Leave side, to say, okay, you would be a lot worse off. And that's not, if you look at the polling, to say they thought they would be a lot worse off and therefore they voted because they wanted these other things. And of course, I don't think we know yet, but I think it is clearly topical and it's interesting, but it's not, you can't say a referendum vote and then afterwards sort of try and disentangle the survey evidence and say, oh no, that the Switzerland model was what they wanted. If you had wanted that, you would have had to have a much clearer articulation of what is the model that will then replace membership, and that was not present.
One, another question, anybody? Yes, please. Go on. So we won't stay till 1:30 if there aren't more questions, but any more we'd love to take.
Thank you for being here, first of all. If there is a message which the Brexit vote gave us, is that direct democracy is not the proper and best way to address topics like European Union projects, evolutions. Now, isn't it a bit contradictory to affirm that British people voted for leaving the European Union but didn't provide the UK government with the way this Brexit should be led, the negotiation itself? On the other hand, I don't see an alternative to a micromanagement for the British negotiation on Brexit by the UK government itself. I don't know if I'm clear. On the one hand, it's bad to give the voice to the people, because apparently the biggest proportion of voters for leaving the European Union were not properly qualified or experts in terms of what could be the consequences of this. On the other hand, like, it's impossible to ask them to define the way Brexit should happen. So I don't really see an alternative to the micromanagement of the Brexit talks by the UK, even if it is hard Brexit, soft Brexit. No? This is my question.
Before you sit down, when you say micromanagement, I mean, who would you imagine would do the micromanaging? Give him the microphone back just for a second. I'm not trying to put you on the spot more than a little, but who would you imagine would do the micromanaging?
No, for me it's quite natural that after the Brexit vote now, it's Theresa May and their government which are gonna lead the talks. But it is quite clear that they just received a vote for leave, and there was no any...
Given your dislike for the tyranny of the majority, use that term, or the use of the referendum, what about the role of Parliament, given that we're next door to the High Court where that all started? Parliament representing the people in a mediated way, or the government using the royal prerogative in the UK? I mean, is there a role for Parliament in this?
I don't really think that this Parliament nowadays has the legitimation for proposing our own views. Like, either new general elections, which I don't think is properly healthy for the UK now, because the timing is not going to be that good, but I don't know what's the difference between this Westminster Parliament and the UK government. None of them had been elected with the purpose of leading the Brexit negotiations, right? I find it quite contradictory now to say, oh, Theresa May has not the power to do so, the Parliament should intervene. Of course, there is major representation in the Parliament, but if I were a UK citizen, I wouldn't be happy that this Parliament, which has not been elected for this purpose, will let the talk. So either Theresa May proceeds without critics or general elections in the UK. This is my view, of course.
I was just curious to know. Four members of the Supreme Court kind of agreed, did you, I think? Anyway.
One slight caveat here. When you say that the majority of people were not qualified, when I put up the showing that there's a correlation between not having qualification, educational qualification, voting leave, that's not to say that people without educational qualifications were not as qualified as people, graduates, to vote on this. I mean, I absolutely will not have my view be that people were not qualified. I think quite the opposite. I think that this was, when we compare with other EU referendums, this was very much a campaign where I think the choices were made quite clear. There was clearly high engagement, so it was a big, you know, democratic exercise, and there was high engagement from citizens. And I certainly, any view sort of to say, well, people didn't know what they were voting for, they weren't qualified, or that somehow a graduate education is necessary for people to be able to vote in these things or to be seen as competent, I think is dangerous. Now that said, I think it's an excellent point. Well, direct democracy is always embedded in representative institutions, never just sort of floating free. There's a referendum, and then, in a sense, it comes back to the representative institution. I think you're making an excellent point about, is this parliament, given that it's a parliament that was very much overwhelmingly in favor of remaining, in the best institutions? And all, you know, in that sense, I think you can make a democratic argument for saying, yes, it should be the representative institutions taking the lead on that. I think this is, you can't keep asking people about these very detailed policy trade-offs, but should it be a new parliament instead that was giving a new mandate? That is certainly an argument to be had, but I think it's always up to the representative institutions to interpret whatever sort of binary mandate is given in a referendum, and then they will be then ultimately held to account. Of course, the slight problem with something like Brexit is that you can hold them to account in a sense, you can vote out Theresa May, but once we're out in the EU with what particular trade, you know, we're out, so you can't, you know, redo that. But I think that's a very interesting point. I mean, maybe we should have had another vote, because you might think, I mean, Theresa May doesn't have any more legitimacy to do it necessarily than other MPs, and that she was also, you know, no one voted for her or her particular line on Brexit in 2015. So I think that's a great point. You know, we want the representative institutions to take over, but should they have been given a fresh mandate with this in mind?
And it would be very, very hard for Parliament to negotiate, wouldn't it? You have to have a team, a small team, which can make rapid decisions as it goes along. I mean, doing that by Parliament, you know, it's rather like trying to work out. I mean, of course, there's been a confusion in the UK by Parliament putting votes about an international intervention. Sorry, governments putting votes about international intervention to Parliament, which is effectively what stopped Cameron becoming involved, and the Cameron government becoming involved in Syria, as I remember. So the confusion about whether government decides to allow Parliament sometimes to have at least a view in the decision making, and on the other hand, how government or some institution then negotiates in the negotiation, I think it's a very good point, actually. Mm. We're agreed on that's a good point. Very good. Yeah.
Do you think that the fact that 10 Eastern countries have joined the EU in 2004 has triggered Euroscepticism among Western countries' citizens?
I think that particularly this intra-EU immigration is particularly a concern in Britain, interestingly enough. Clearly there were very, very an unanticipated large numbers of Central and Eastern European citizens coming to Britain after 2004, and the government vastly underestimated. So I think it did several things. First of all, it meant that British citizens really didn't believe anything the government said on immigration after that. And it meant that there was clearly concerns about immigration that have been present a long time in Britain became very closely linked to EU and the concept of freedom of movement. It's slightly different on most of the continent. So it's also immigration concern that drives a lot of the support for the populist right. But there are generally concerns about Muslim immigration, immigrants coming from outside the European Union, particularly from Muslim countries, which is sort of seen as a cultural and security threat in a different way that people coming from Central and Eastern Europe. So if you ask these questions in it's not that those concerns don't exist, but the concerns about immigration from inside the EU tends to be higher here. And I think that was linked to what happened after those two eastwards enlargements and the fact that so many people came to Britain.
One more? Anybody happy? Let me try one more then, just to end with. As you rightly say, Sarah, nobody will ever fully know why, in a sense, people voted to leave the EU. There were a whole range of reasons, some of which you hinted at earlier. But we know what the top two or three, well, we probably have a pretty good clue what some of the top ones were. Mm-hmm. Migration was one, as you said. A response to long-term economic change linked to global economic change might have been another. Not liking the EU was clearly there, and being pro-UK sovereignty was there, I mean, and others besides, some of them personal, no doubt. But my question is, which links to the election of Donald Trump, though I realise they're two separate, completely separate things, is given that people voted for leaving the EU with these objectives in mind, will they be disappointed if they don't get what they think they voted for? Do we know? Is there any evidence at all that they really expect these things to change?
That's a great question. I think what the referendum did, which I think people will get, which there was a sense of empowerment, and you mentioned that before, the people who felt they haven't really had any influence. They, for example, they might have been UKIP supporters or something close to it, and they've never been able to vote for UKIP in any meaningful way. Even if they're Labour supporters, they kept voting for Labour, and they didn't get what they wanted in terms of on immigration or the economy or whatever. And there was a real choice. And what these citizens will get, and I believe they will get that, is that Great Britain will leave the European Union. So there's a very tangible, you know, in a sense, win in terms of political empowerment for people who have not felt empowered by it. So, and in Trump, it seems he's delivering on campaign promises as well. But so in that sense, there's a win. Now, then the second question is, which is what I said was ultimately, is what is the price for that win? And there, of course, there might be some, you know, if we have, you know, a major economic downturn, like a lot of economists predicted, we don't know yet whether that's going to happen, but obviously that's going to hit a lot of people. And if we know that there is a correlation between having low levels of qualifications and voting for leave, I mean, that's more likely to, you know, hit people at that end of the educational distribution. So that, of course, might create a backlash, but I think the backlash would have been even greater in terms of if Runar said, well, we know this is not really good for you, that's not really what you wanted. I think, you know, a lot of, well, not a lot, but some people have thought of, well, now when they're seeing how bad it's getting and look at the pound, maybe we should have a second referendum. And I think if there was a second referendum now, it would be an even bigger Leave majority. So I think there is a very tangible win and feeling of empowerment coming from the fact that people voted to leave against the recommendations of most parliamentarians, and there will be the result that Britain leaves the European Union.
Okay. Well, that's a great note to finish on. We'll finish a little bit early, but I know people have lectures to go to, things to do. I'd just like to, before I thank Sarah once more, advertise next week's lecture, which will be on Wednesday, on the 1st of February. That's January done for. And that's going to be on experts, trust and populism, so an issue that goes from strength to strength and has been given lots of further stimulus in the last few days. And we'll hear from Abby Innes, Jonathan White and Richard Bronk of the European Institute. So hope to see you again next week. But once again, I'd just like to thank Sarah Holbolt and thank you all for coming. Thank you very much.